Welcome to the Cowbell Kingdom Road Reaction post-game show. The Sacramento Kings keep winning. They improved to 9-5 tonight despite missing Rudy Gay, Darren Collison. Somehow they piece it together. Rui Thomas, what is going on here with the Sacramento Kings?
Well, I don't know. Maybe we should just let all hell break loose. You know, that's happening around the country. But I think guys are stepping up. You know, where we aren't expecting from, right? Rudy Gay was out tonight, and in the first quarter, we saw Ben McLemore shoot 3 for 3 for 7 points and hit a three at the beginning of the fourth quarter, or sorry, second quarter, right? So he started the game 4 for 4, 10 points, helping fill in, you know, the lack of offense by Gay. Then we saw Sessions step in Collison's shoes very formidably. I believe he finished with 15 points and 6 assists and 2 turnovers, right? In his last start, when he filled in for Collison in Dallas, he had 0 assists. So we saw 2 guys, you know, come up big when they needed offense from someone besides Cousins. And then also the very strong bench effort, right? Aside from Derek Williams, we saw Landry, McCallum, and Stauskas really play well tonight.
Yeah, definitely. The bench played extremely well. But let's focus on the starters for a second. I think you're right. Ramon Sessions comes in. He has a tremendous game, 15 points, 6 assists, like you said. And more to that, you know, he has 2 steals. He struggled from the field still. He's 4 of 13 from the field. But he kept the pedal down. He's 6 of 8 from the line. He was aggressive when things weren't going his way. I know his first 2 shots were literally layups that he just bricked that were horrible. And it was like, oh boy, are we going to see the bad Ramon Sessions or are we going to see the good Ramon Sessions? Either way, he shook it off. And then Ray McCallum, because Sessions is starting for Collison, Ray McCallum fills in, comes off the bench, drops in 12 points, gives a, you know, it grabs 3 rebounds, 4 of 7 from the field. But huge, huge moments for Ray McCallum where he played great defense. He played really solid overall. I thought he was one of the sort of the stalwarts of this game. But the guy that sticks out to me, we're going to get to our players of the game later, but my goodness, Rui, Omri Caspi, he just, like, he's a freight train. 22 points in 36 minutes, 9 of 14 shooting, 4 rebounds, an assist, a steal. The dude was all over the court, and as soon as he gets the ball on the wing, man, he just runs right at the goal. It's just really, really fun to watch.
Yeah, you know, he's kind of like what Tyreek Evans should have been in his 4 years with the Kings, right? Just driving without abandon, right? Just not bothering to pull up for mid-range shots. He did take 2 threes, and he made 1 nice 3. But this guy, he has a first step that is lightning fast, right? Apparently no one can keep up with it, and then he's strong enough to finish in the paint. So, yeah, 9 of 14 shooting for 22 points tonight. He admirably stepped in for Rudy Gay. And, you know, Malone, right, he made the right call pregame, plugging him in instead of Derek Williams.
Yeah, Malone makes the right call, but then Malone gets tossed from the game. I think that's one big moment in this game where Malone was really upset with an on-call. Not quite sure what happened. If Malone got a first tee and he didn't realize it, clearly, he did get a first tee, and, I mean, the game kind of stopped. And then Malone thought that he hadn't picked up a tee. Then he went nuts and got tossed from the game. I thought that was a really pivotal moment in this game where things could have gone really south. I mean, the Kings are still a young team. They have struggled on the road here and there. You know, here they are out on the road on a 4-game trip, and somehow they win their first 2 even without their coach. Tyrone Corbin steps in admirably and really gives them everything they need to sort of solidify this team down the stretch. You know, DeMarcus Cousins, who was very upset when Malone got tossed, he settles down and, I mean, just dominates the third quarter. There were some really, really interesting tidbits in this game where guys stepped up in pivotal moments tonight. I don't know what the deal is. But guys stepped up, and that's exactly what you have to have happen when your coach is gone, your starting point guard is gone, your number 2 man, you know, all-star level small forward is gone. And I thought we just saw a tremendous effort by multiple Kings tonight.
Oh yes, yeah. Again, scratch Derek Williams, right? He came out there and he shot 0 for 5, right, pulling up for jump shots and taking wild layups. But other than that, everyone brought their A game and then some. You know, yeah. In the beginning of that third quarter, right? Cousins just took over, scored the first 8 points in the quarter, and then we saw Caspi add 9 for the quarter. Cousins finished with 10 for the quarter, but the Kings, they just clamped down on defense the whole night. And their offense, right? We just had contributions from everybody, which helped fill it in.
You know, Rui, you brought up defense, and that's a good segue to the guy that we should be talking about in this game. Before we get to our 3 points to the game, we're going to talk about Jason Thompson a little bit. Jason Thompson, again, sort of the much maligned Jason Thompson. He's marching his way towards the all-time Sacramento Kings record for games played. 59 games coming into the season. We're 14 games into the season, so he's 45 games away from being the all-time leader, taking over for Peja Stojakovic, if that does in fact happen. But tonight, he scores 0 points, and he grabs 7 rebounds, and he plays 33 minutes. And I think someone who looks at the box score looks at this and goes, "Man, Jason Thompson just killing the Kings." You know, again, 0 points. He's killing these guys. But the fact is, Jason Thompson held Anthony Davis, who has been otherworldly. I mean, Anthony Davis has been so incredible lately, but he holds Davis to 14 points, 9 rebounds in 38 minutes. Davis shoots just 4 of 12 from the field, never gets in a rhythm, never finds his stroke. And you know, realistically, Jason Thompson is one of the heroes of this game, despite going scoreless. What were your thoughts on Jason Thompson's effort?
Oh, a wonderful. I mean, yeah, he was invisible on the offensive end. He shot 0 for 3 and only had one offensive rebound, right? Yeah, I mean, he's a fantasy player's worst nightmare.
Isn't
But
he?
yeah, you look at his numbers compared to the rest of his career, and it seems like he's having the worst year ever, when in reality, he's having his best season ever. Right, we've seen him play lockdown defense on Kenneth Faried, Blake Griffin, LaMarcus Aldridge, and now Davis, right? Davis only had 2 points in 11 minutes of action in the third quarter, and then 3 points in the last quarter. So Thompson really making his impact there. You know, when Thompson comes off the when he's playing with a second unit too, I think he really helps the Kings, right? He's kind of the besides Hollins, he's the other player you can, you know, consider a center on this roster, and I think he really holds things down there as well.
Yeah, I think when the Kings go straight to the bench, they seem to have issues. Tonight, not so much. You know, we just keep beating on Derek Williams, but let's skip Derek Williams and just talk about, you know, again, we already talked about McCallum. Stauskas comes in. Stauskas has been struggling. He hasn't done much lately. Tonight, 9 points on in 24 minutes, shoots 4 of 6 from the field. He does hit 1 of 3 from behind the arc, and that 1 3 he hit, I swear the rim looked like it was like the size of my Honda CRV. You know, Karl Landry came in and really solidified the offense at 1.2. Early in the game, he tried to go up against Jeff Withey, and that was just such a horrible decision by Landry. I mean, you know, Withey does nothing but block shots. He ends up with 3 blocks, and I think probably most of those three, well, I guess only one of them could be against Karl Landry, because Karl Landry finishes 4 or 5 from the field with 9 points. Not a great defensive effort. I mean, a rebounding effort from Landry. But you know, this Kings team is built to kind of beat you up and you know, team rebound. A lot of guys grabbing rebounds. I think it's this was one of the better efforts that we've seen from the bench all season, and hopefully this carries forward, because the Kings have a huge game tomorrow night against the huge Houston Rockets. It's never nice to play back to back, especially when you're lacking two of your starters. I mean, 40% of the Kings' starting lineup is sitting on the bench with injuries, and we don't know how long Rudy Gay is going to be out. He continues to struggle with the Achilles tendonitis. Collison has a thigh bruise, maybe a strain there as well. Neither of these guys could go, and you just see what this team has kind of built this season is that while guys might not have big numbers, they still contribute, and that's something that the Sacramento Kings in the past maybe have not done. All right, Rui, let's get to your 3 points to the game. I keep talking to you about this. Your 3 points to the game seem to always hit right, you know, the nail on the head. And tonight, a clash of titans. We get Anthony Davis, who is coming off like a huge, huge 43-point performance against the the Utah Jazz on Saturday, and he goes up against DeMarcus Cousins. My goodness, in that third quarter, DeMarcus Cousins just showed everybody in America why he is right now the best big man in America. His performance in that third, especially the first like 3 minutes where he drops 8 points, was just incredible, inside, outside. Rui, what are your thoughts on the performance of DeMarcus Cousins versus Anthony Davis tonight?
Well, it's interesting because right, both of these guys are they're growing up in the West and they're blossoming before our eyes, right? So I think they're going to be compared to for the next 15 years. But you know, DeMarcus, he showed tonight, right? He relied on his jumper, his mid-range game. He was pulling out a seek from the paint and he was nailing those. He had a really nice step-back jumper in the beginning of the third quarter, and you know, he continued to crash the boards. He bullied a seek. He covered. When Davis was covering him, you know, he worked him as well. So yeah, Cousins finished with the 22 points, 12 boards, and 5 assists, feeding guys when they were trapping down on him. And he had 3 steals, 5 turnovers. Right. I mean, he was getting trapped so often. I guess you can excuse that.
He's got to deal with that. Yeah, that's an issue still. It is.
But he was perfect from the line. You know, Davis was he dropped, I believe, 28 points on the Kings when they played last time, and yeah, absolutely frustrated tonight. Couldn't get anything going. Missed a couple big free throws. Only finished with 9 boards and 14 points, two blocks. Yeah, Cousins definitely run round 2. So we'll see what happens next time.
Yeah, I'm gonna give the nod to Cousins big time. I mean, honestly, you're right. We are going to see these guys sort of, I mean, they're going to be the center and power forward combo in the Western Conference All-Star game for the next, I don't know, decade. I mean, that's who these guys are. These guys are so incredible. I think right now, DeMarcus Cousins is a better player. Maybe for the next 2 or 3 years, DeMarcus Cousins will be a better player. But at some point, I mean, you have to look at how young Anthony Davis is, and his ceiling is so incredibly high. You have to think that he's going to find a way to be just great. I mean, he is a very, very solid NBA player, and the sky is the limit for this guy. The one thing I really like about this matchup tonight is what you brought up about Asik. Asik is probably the best post defender in the game right now, especially at the center position. He's a guy that absolutely covers most centers. Just he shuts them down. And when you have Davis next to him and then Ryan Anderson off the bench, it makes this like 3 big man combos so incredibly deadly. I mean, Davis leads the league in shot block, if I'm not mistaken. Anderson, again, tonight goes for over 20 with his 3-point shooting. But Cousins drew a Sheik out, which allowed Sessions to go inside and do his damage. And then as soon as a Sheik came out, he ran right by Ashik and just embarrassed him and went right to the glass and scored. This is such a like an incredible thing to watch, sort of the maturation of DeMarcus Cousins, him taking his game to the next level every single time out. And it's really fun to watch. It's something that, you know, we're going to continue to watch him grow. As soon as he figures out how to, A, stop fouling people, and, B, stop turning the ball over, we're going to see this kid, you know, realistically bump up to 27, 28 points a game, 13, 14 rebounds a game, close to 2 blocks a game. I mean, and then once he figures out how to pass out of the double team and his teammates figure out how to work off of him, we're going to see Cousins, again, take a huge, huge bump as far as the assist numbers. And so, again, you know, the sky's the limits for Anthony Davis, but I think they are for DeMarcus Cousins as well, who realistically won the battle tonight. All right, Rui, let's shift to defending the deep ball. And again, you pointed this out. This was such a crucial part to this game. And I'm going to let you run with this because it is such a huge point to this game and how the Kings were able to pull off the 99-89 win tonight.
Okay, so if you remember last match, right, the Kings, they would collapse in the paint and leave Ryan Anderson for, you know, Lord knows what reason.
Wide open. Yeah.
Right. I mean, frankly, the Pelicans should have made more threes in the last game. They blew a bunch of wide-open chances. But tonight, they held the Pelicans to 1 of 6 from behind the arc in the first quarter, 2 of 9 in the at the half, and then 3 of 15 after 3 quarters, right? They finished the night 3 of 17, and I believe you made the point that Ryan Anderson right? He made all of those threes. So I know, like, Tyreek Evans took three clanks. We saw Drew Holiday miss three more. Babbitt didn't get anything going. The Kings, they definitely stuck to their man on the perimeter. And, right, the Pelicans, they need to make threes, and they couldn't tonight.
Yeah, I think it's really a good point. I mean, Jimmer Fredette misses a three. You know, we haven't – Jimmer didn't play last time they were out here, but Austin Rivers, a good three-point shooter. You can tell by the low three-point attempts by some of these guys. I mean, Darius Miller took a three in the first half that was just horrible and had no business shooting. But Evans, Holiday, 0 of 6, a starting backcourt, and then a bunch of, like, little three-point, like, 0 of 1, 0 of 1, 0 of 1 – off the bench, and then Ryan Anderson's 3 of 7. That tells me that the Sacramento Kings were guarding the three-point line, and that, you know, heaven forbid, you were able to leave Jason Thompson down on Anthony Davis sort of alone and play him straight up. That's huge, and it allows you to play better defense overall. And you can't stop Ryan Anderson. He's so good. He finds a way to hit threes in transition. He finds a way to bury you wherever he can. But the Kings did a really solid job of slowing down the rest of the team. I mean, again, Ryan Anderson, 3 of 7, and the rest of the team, 0 of 10. And that's what you have to do if you want to defend the perimeter and at the NBA level. A great shooter is going to figure out a way to beat you here and there, but you got to limit the touches for the other guys. You have to limit their opportunities. All right, so let's hit this last point. And again, this is so spot on, a need for steals. Last time the Kings played these guys, they only turned the ball over 6 times. And the Kings, they had like 1 or 2 steals. It was like absolutely embarrassing. But tonight we saw a different story. So let me kick it back over to you. Hey, look at that. I've left it on you this whole time. I'm going to kick it back over to you, Rui, and you tell us about the steals tonight.
Right. Well, in the first quarter, the Kings did create some havoc, right? Last match, Drew Holiday had a sparkling 9-0 assist to turnover ratio, right, which helped orchestrate the Pelicans offense. And then tonight he has a turnover within the first minute. And I believe the Pelicans finished that quarter. They had 4 team turnovers, I believe. But anyway, they surrendered 17 points off turnovers for the game. You know, the Kings started spilling the ball. The Kings had, I believe they had 3 or 4 turnovers in the second quarter, but other than that, they managed to keep it down to a minimum. And the Pelicans struggled with, you know, taking care of the ball tonight. They had 10 turnovers. Or sorry, 11 turnovers.
11 is a word. I swear it is. All right, yeah, 11 turnovers. And I think the biggest key to tonight's game, and it points to your key to the game, is that of the 11 turnovers, 9 of them were Sacramento Kings steals. I mean, DeMarcus Cousins comes away with 3 steals. I remember in the first quarter, the first or second quarter, I put out a tweet sort of mocking Omer Asik. As soon as that guy puts the ball on the floor, it's like, oh boy, just take it from him. I mean, he has no business putting the ball on the floor at all. He's one of the worst offensive players we've ever seen. I mean, outside of a dunk here and there, he had 1 layup tonight that was nice, but outside of like a dunk typically, the guy is absolutely useless. I mean, from outside of 3 feet, he shoots like less than 40% from the field, like over the last couple of years. He's just horrible outside of the circle area. So I think it was really interesting to see the Kings forcing turnovers, you said it led to, I think it was 17 points, 11 turnovers leading to 17 points. That is a tremendous ratio for the Sacramento Kings. That means that it is exactly what we saw. It was Omri Caspi grabbing the ball, getting the ball on the lead out off a steal, and going right at the rim and scoring. I think that was sort of the transition there. All right, Rui, let's go to our players of the game. I know who mine is, but I'm gonna kick it over to you, and you can start with players of the game tonight.
Okay, let's mix it up a bit, right? This is my one chance to give a player of the game to a guy who scored 0 points, and I'm gonna go with Jason Thompson. You know, Jason Thompson,
wow.
He matches up really well with Davis. You know, like having a 6'11" power forward in today's NBA is a luxury, and on top of that, he's really strong. Came into this season, right, definitely working hard in the gym in the off season. So he was able to body up Davis And you know, Davis didn't try to take him outside, so you know they battled down low, and Thompson definitely came away with it, right? And you can't count out those 7 rebounds either. You know, he is a big reason why the Kings are so dominant on the boards this season.
All right, you're going to go with Jason Thompson. I agree that Jason Thompson is in my top 2 or 3 for this game. I thought he was spectacular on the defensive end. I'm going to go with Caspi. I mean, he runs a +7 on the night, but a 36-minute performance in the clutch, starting in place of Rudy Gay, who was not able to go with the tendonitis in the Achilles. You get 22 points out of a guy that you had no idea you were going to get anything out of. I think tonight, you know, Caspi came into this game 1 of 9 from behind the arc on the season. He hits 1 of 2 tonight, which was very, very good to see. Again, he pushed the tempo. He drove sort of the pace of this game for much of it. And I think on the other side, you know, I thought he did a really nice job in stints on the offensive, on the defensive end. Again, you know, Miller goes for 0 points on 0 of 3 shooting. They, you know, Babbitt comes off the bench and gets 0. They mixed and matched guys. They played Tyreek Evans there at the small forward a little bit. And he did have a solid 22.5 assists, 7 rebound night on 10 of 17 shooting, 38 minutes. But I just think that Caspi was the difference in this game. I mean, you saw what DeMarcus Cousins was able to do in the third quarter. He was a wrecking ball. But at the same time, you know, he scores 10 and Caspi scores 9 in that quarter. I wouldn't have taken him off the field, off the court tonight. I thought he was so good and so much fun to watch that he would have got, you know, close to 48 minutes, despite tomorrow night being a back-to-back. So definitely a strong performance by Omri Caspi, in my opinion. But, you know, there are a couple of guys that could have got some nods in this, including Sessions, who, again, 15.6 assists. Cousins, you know, that's Cousins' 7th straight double-double. He's got 11 in 14 games on the season. So, you know, very, very solid performance out of all of the Kings that played, except for Derek Williams. So, Rui, do you have anything else for us tonight?
Sure. How about a shout out to Ray, right? 6 big points in the fourth quarter. And,
oh, yeah.
You know, I think he has trouble with his dribbling and driving sometimes, but he looked absolutely fine tonight, right? Like Caspi, he was powering the ball coast to coast, and his mid-range jumper looked amazing tonight. So, you know, we might be able to expect a little more Ray moving forward after this. And also, you know, losing Malone, right? You can't downplay that in the second quarter. A lot of credit needs to go to Tyron Corbin and, you know, his game plan. He was, you know, I heard Keith Smart comparisons to him when he was in Utah as far as his rotations went. But, you know, everything went fine tonight. And I think that the Kings, you know, managing to handle being without the, you know, the big three of Malone, Gay, and Carlson is, again, another sign of their maturity.
Definitely a good point. Sign of maturity. And I don't know what's happening here, but the Sacramento Kings are 9-5 on the season. They do still have a protest hanging out there in the Memphis game, which could make them 10-4. Heaven forbid that thing comes through. I want to point out this, too. The month of December, while the month of November is absolutely brutal, and we keep talking about this incredible, like, incredibly tough schedule. I think it's listed as the 2nd toughest schedule in the NBA. The Kings have motored through it like it's not even there. I mean, how they keep winning is shocking. They keep punching people in the face and you know, sort of they're the aggressor in every single game. Now, you get to the month of December, and here's some crazy stats. 11 of 15 at home. Of the 4 road games, 2 of them, the early 2 games in the month, 1 is in L.A. against the Lakers, and 1 is in Golden State. Of the 15 games total, they have 8 against the Eastern Conference. Eastern Conference is weak sauce. We all know that. The Eastern Conference is not very good again this year. And the Kings have not played the Eastern Conference very often. They've played a lot of Western Conference games so far. So they're going to get like really fed well in the month of December when it comes to Eastern Conference opponents. They finished the month with a couple of games on the road, I think New Jersey and someone else. But either way, it's a very, very favorable schedule. And the Kings already have 9 wins. This is absolutely shocking to most people. You know, they get the Rockets tomorrow night. They come back on Friday night against San Antonio, which isn't easy, but then they're back home on Sunday. This team has a chance here to make some major headway. They may even be able to get above 20 wins before we turn the new year. So lots of excitement in Sacramento Kings land. A ton of good stuff going on. I want to give a shout-out to DeMarcus Cousins, who won the Western Conference Player of the Week. He could very well win the Western Conference Player of the Month for the month of November. We will find that out shortly. But if the Kings keep winning, this has been something that we've talked about with Cousins in the past. If the Kings win, DeMarcus Cousins will get all of the accolades that he wants. And so far this season, he's getting them, and it is specifically because he is winning games. His shooting percentage is higher than it has been in the past, but he's still turning the ball over. He's still picking up fouls. His ascension into the upper tier of statistical performers as far as rebounding, I mean, he does lead the league in rebounding, but as far as points, it's not there because he's not playing 36 minutes a night. So as soon as he starts figuring things out, we're going to see him climb the ladder even further, which is very, very cool to see. So I don't know. This is a fun run by the Sacramento Kings. Rui, I think that's going to do it for this episode of the Cowbell Kingdom Road Reaction Show. Do you have anything else for us? I don't know.
We'll be here for the back-to-back tomorrow.
That's right. We will be here for the back-to-back against the Houston Rockets tomorrow night. So, for Rui Thomas, I am James Hamm. You've been watching the Cowbell Kingdom Road Reaction Postgame Show. We'll be back tomorrow.